Hey, what's up, guys? I wanted to offer a diagram that I use to help visualize the flow of money in the economy. A lot of people can get lost when they're examining, you know, the impact of credit money, interest rates, how models like LSLM work, and setting up flowcharts like this has really helped me conceptually, so I'm hoping it helps you too. Let's get started. Okay, so the model breaks the flow of money into two different directions. If you're any of these entities, government, households, or companies, and you receive a dollar, you have two basic decisions. You can either spend the dollar on consumption, in which case it is part of aggregate demand, it's spent on goods and services, or you can choose to save the dollar, in which case it gets pushed into financial markets for investment. And this is a really important distinction to make because the nominal output from companies in wages and profits and taxes is not necessarily going to be equal to the nominal input they receive in aggregate demand. And aggregate demand is the market signals that tell companies how much to produce, how many people to hire. And so it's really important to understand that when someone saves a dollar, it is subtracting from aggregate demand. And when someone spends a dollar, it is adding to aggregate demand. Okay, so once a government, household, or company saves a dollar and it ends up inside of financial markets, how does it get converted back into aggregate demand? The simplest way of understanding it is that these entities borrow the money. Government issues deficit spending and they borrow it by issuing bonds. Households buy mortgages, they have credit card debt, etc. Corporate borrowing, they're issuing corporate bonds and IPOs and things like that to get money out of the financial market. But the key thing to understand is that this process of each of these entities saving and borrowing is critical to the aggregate demand. Because if this mechanism isn't balanced, you're going to get ups and downs in nominal aggregate demand. For example, if households are borrowing and corporations are borrowing and government is borrowing at the exact same rate that they are saving and deleveraging their debt, then aggregate demand is going to be 100%. It's essentially in equilibrium. However, if households and corporations and governments stop borrowing altogether, you can see that a lot of savings gets stuck into the financial system, in which case aggregate demand declines. And this is exactly what happens during a recession. These households and these corporate, they stop borrowing, they start deleveraging their debt. After 2007, this is a massive deleveraging. Household outstanding debt obligations are still declining. But so you can see how this actually affects the economy. When the market goes bust and households and corporations stop borrowing, that eliminates these two flows into aggregate demand. And what they're doing is they're pumping money, paying down debt back into savings, right? They're pumping money, paying down the principal on their debt, and it eliminates these two flows of aggregate demand. That's a huge amount of money. So you can see that the argument of austerity versus fiscal deficits is a really critical argument, because technically, if government starts doing austerity and cutting their deficit, that means you have a scenario where government, households, and companies are all deleveraging. They're all putting money back towards financial markets, and none of it is coming out in the form of borrowing. And this causes a drastic decline in aggregate demand. And this is a big part of what causes recessions. So what is the ideal scenario? Well, if households are borrowing and saving at the same rate, government should have neutral fiscal policy. And the same is true of corporations. If they are borrowing and saving and deleveraging at the same rate, they're at an equilibrium. Only the amount of leverage indicates the risk that they're at. So basically, if households and corporations are going on a spending spree and they're borrowing a lot more than they're saving, that means they're pumping up aggregate demand. What governments should do is pay off their debt. they should cut off this flow, and that should help stabilize the economy, stabilize both prices and growth. And the opposite is true. During a recession, when households and corporations cut off their borrowing stream, government needs to borrow a ton. Government needs to borrow a ton in order to maintain equilibrium inside of aggregate demand, because households and corporations are not converting any of their savings or their debt into consumption. And that's a really important thing to understand. Now, there are lots of arguments involved in that, like what is the highest quality of borrowing? I would say that corporations borrowing to invest in productive capacity is the highest quality of borrowing, because it actually increases the output of goods and services. I would say that household borrowing is rather neutral. I mean, it can be beneficial for households to buy long-term mortgage debt, but for the most part, I would consider consumer spending relatively neutral. Government spending is the wild card. Obviously, there's no guarantee that government is going to spend their money wisely. And so you're going to get really good infrastructure investment, and you're going to get really silly investments in companies that were never meant to be. But the key point is that if you're in a recessionary spiral, if households and corporations are deleveraging and paying down debt at the same time, you have no choice. You have to go with this wild card of fiscal deficit spending. And there's a lot of ways that they can do it, actually. You know, they can either issue new bonds and increase their borrowing level to increase their spending, but they can also cut taxes. You know, this is the classic left versus right argument. You know, conservatives will say you need to cut income taxes, and that increases consumer spending and consumer investment. And government says, no, I'm going to issue new bonds and increase spending that way. But in both scenarios, the government's deficit blows up. It blows up either by decreased revenues, or it blows up by increasing the amount of bonds that they circulate. So who is right in this scenario? Well, this is why I break households down into 1%, 10%, 40%, and 50%. Because each of these brackets has a different marginal propensity to save. Meaning, when you give a broad-based income tax cut, it goes back to each one of these entities. The bottom 50% get very little because they pay very little in income taxes. These middle 40% and top 10% may use it to spend it on consumption, but they could, if it's a recessionary time, end it put it into paying down their debt, or even, you know, contribute some of it to savings. But the top 1%, they're going to take at least 50 to 90% of that tax cut, and it's going to go straight here into savings. And so a tax cut is not necessarily the best way to get the cash flowing towards aggregate demand, towards consumption. On the other hand, if government keeps, you know, income taxes and payroll taxes steady, and they instead decide to issue more bonds, bring in money this way, then they can increase spending, and they can maintain the current spending levels and saving levels of households. It's a much more predictable way to contribute to aggregate demand, and I argue that it's a much more effective way to contribute to aggregate demand, simply because when government increases the principal on their deficit, they're going to be spending it, whereas households don't necessarily have to do that. It could actually aid the problem by deleveraging their debt even. So what we can see from when households are deleveraging, paying off debt, or borrowing is that this is pretty much what Keynes intuitively recognized in the 1930s, when he identified aggregate demand as the key problem, the key nominal problem to why there was deflationary pressure in the economy. And so basically what was happening in the Great Depression, along with some blunders by the Federal Reserve, is households and corporations were not borrowing. They were saving their money, and they were paying down their debt. And so what Keynes said is, hey man, we gotta the government's really got a deficit spend if you want to maintain this nominal signal, this market signal that companies are receiving inside of aggregate demand. And he was absolutely right. Okay, so I wanted to talk a little bit about quantitative easing in the framework of this diagram to explain to folks why it hasn't caused any kind of inflation whatsoever. So we have our central bank over here, and the central bank is kind of this external anomaly that influences the economy. And there's a couple of different ways that they influence the economy, and it's all going to make a lot of sense to you how it works inside of this diagram. So the central bank essentially issues new currency, new reserves, and purchases mostly government securities from financial money markets, financial bond markets, etc. And the rate at which they do this conversion of bond into new currency determines the federal funds rate. And so if they set a target rate of, say, 0% or 0.25%, which is pretty close to what it has been, by issuing new currency and liquidating, essentially, bonds, what they're doing is they're setting the rates on these yellow lines. You know, this is 0.25%. Sorry for the clumsy writing. But, you know, they set each one of these rates here, and that influences how money enters in aggregate demand. You can see he pushes the rate all the way to zero. That's encouraging all of these entities to borrow. It's encouraging households to take on debt with cheap mortgages and low-interest short-term debt. It's encouraging corporations to take on debt, and really encouraging Treasury to take on debt because they can borrow at almost zero interest. And so you can see how the Fed manipulating the monetary base up here in the financial markets essentially influences the incentives of borrowing. Now, during a recession, these households and corporations aren't borrowing no matter what the rate is. You know, the rate has been next to nothing for half of a decade now, and they're still deleveraging. And so, but the government can borrow very, very cheaply. So why doesn't quantitative easing cause inflation? Well, quantitative easing, you know, Fed typically buys short-term debt, but quantitative easing was focused on long-term interest rates. But in any case, it doesn't really matter. If the Fed is pumping a bunch of money into financial markets, cash reserves, that's all fine and dandy. It deleverages banks. Like, banks feel more solvent because they have a lot more cash floating around that's backing all of those delicious interest earning deposits. But it doesn't necessarily mean that this cash is going to end up inside of aggregate demand. It will not, it cannot end up inside of aggregate demand unless one of these entities borrow it. It won't do it. So during a recessionary time, like we have seen lately, when households and corporations have been paying down debt, deleveraging, it doesn't matter how many assets the Fed liquidates. It could liquidate the entire banking system. If nobody's borrowing the cash, it's not going to end up as a signal to companies to produce more or hire more. Hence, again, why government deficit spending during a recession is such a critical mechanism, because it provides the only outlet for the cash that is building up in the financial system. There are a million topics you can talk about inside of this model, because it's essentially a miniature creation of the economy. But I want to talk about one other influence in the domestic economy, and that is foreign trade deficit, foreign savings, just so people understand how that works, how our market communicates with other markets in the world. And so we have, you know, in foreign countries there's essentially foreign savings and foreign consumption the same way there is here. And our trade deficit is related to foreign consumption. They are consuming our products and we are consuming theirs. And so what a trade deficit and a trade surplus really means for the domestic economy is it's either an addition to our consumption markets, or it's a subtraction. So the United States today is running a trade deficit. That means every time this cycle runs, every time these transactions annually run or whatever, it's essentially draining dollars from consumption markets as they travel to overseas banks. Now, those banks typically, what they end up doing is buying treasuries, and returning the dollars to our domestic market in the form of government spending or government refinancing. But the point being just that, you know, keep in mind that when we do run a trade deficit, that it is subtracting nominal dollars from our aggregate demand. And the opposite is true if we run a surplus, it's adding dollars to our aggregate demand. In a perfect world, countries would do their best to achieve trade balances with one another so that nobody is getting a specific advantage or disadvantage in their economy. I'm all for free trade, but I also believe in fair trade balances as well. The last thing I wanted to show you is more for economic nerds who want to dive a little deeper into what I'm presenting here. It's essentially the same model as before, but with a lot of detail showing, you know, where savings deposits get stored. They essentially are controlled and are stored by pension funds. You know, this is everything from Social Security and government pension funds, household retirement funds, corporate pension funds, and vault reserve savings. And essentially that money gets invested into these money markets and capital markets, and that's how it ends up back into aggregate demand for the most part. And so if you're interested in, you know, using this model to see what's going on in the economy and using data from the Fed and plugging it into these flows, then this one's for you. I'll see if I can publish this as a PDF somewhere and give it to you guys as a link. If I do, I'll end up putting it in the description. Otherwise, that's what I have to offer. I'd love to hear from you. I'd love to hear your comments. One last thing, a lot of people may say, oh, you're not tracking products or anything like that. In my opinion, I think that classical economists and Keynesian economists focus too much on supply and demand, the supply of goods and services and demand, when they really need to be focusing more on savings and demand and work on plotting banks into their economic modeling to see what is going on. Thanks a lot, guys.